Euzubillahimineşşeytanirracim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Elhamdülillah ve salatu ve selamu ala Resulillah ve ala alihi ve sahbihi ve mevla ve mutlada bi hadihi ve sallisi ve mutlada bi hadihi ve sallisi ve It will be my pleasure to introduce Dr. Abdazim Siddiqui. His biography is very, very big. I'm not going to say anything about him. If you're interested, you can look at it. It's posted in the entrance. But the only thing I want to say about him, that I know him for more than 25 years. And although I am qualified very much to be his uncle, but age-wise, he is one of my teachers. And he is very much qualified. And I never really sat down with him at any level, a social level, just asking questions, listening to him as a speaker in lecture. You always learn something from him. Without any further ado, he will, inshallah, will talk to us about the concept of Ummah in Islam.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would not like to comment on whatever thing that my brother Farid has said. But I will just say thank you and jazakallahu khairan. In fact, when we came to this country, Farid was one of those who received, mentored, and supervised us in many ways. So now if he's considering me his teacher, that an honor without any doubt. This is the first time for me to be here with you at this center, and I hope that I will be, in a way, giving you something that you will take home tonight. The concept of the Muslim Ummah, the meaning of the word, the Arabic word Ummah, was not known to the pre-Islamic Arabs. If you will go and study the history of the Arabs, the best and the highest social unit that they know was the tribe of Qabila. And the Arabian poet, if he wants to show pride, he will speak about himself, his family, and his tribe. That is the highest in the social hierarchy that he can go to. The Ummah was a Quranic term introduced by the Quran to the Arabs of that time, and to bring them to a higher level of brotherhood and unity. It is really unfortunate that by the end of the first century, the first Hijri century, following the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions, the Ummah started to fall apart. And when we speak today about the Ummah, we speak about something in theory. Because we are not at the highest level that the Quran wanted us to be. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, إن هذه أمتكم أمة واحدة وأنا ربكم فاعبدون. This is in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter 21, verse 92. And in Surah Al-Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 52, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says almost the same thing, but with a wow at the beginning of the verse, and instead of فَعْبُدُونَ فَاتَّقُونَ. So the Quran says, وَإِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاتَّقُونَ. So in Surah Al-Mu'minun, Al-Anbiya, chapter 21, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is your ummah, one united ummah under God. So try to be united and أَعْبُدُونَ, that means serve me, be my ibad. And in the other verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are one united ummah under God, so fear Allah, fattaqun. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in many other verses in the Quran, I can quote, he said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And then he, that is in Surah Al-Dariyat, chapter 51, verse 56. And in chapter 49, verse 13, Al-Hujurat, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ, for everyone, إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. This is in Surah Al-Hujurat, verse 13, chapter 49. So from these verses combined, I can conclude the following. First, we are supposed to be one united ummah and one God. So the ummah itself was united, and our Lord is one. Allah wahid ahad fa'un sam. And then we are the ummah of faith. Our unity was centered around faith, iman. So immutable iman. This is not just Arabs or Pakistanis or Iranians or Sudanese or Egyptians. Ummatukum wa ana rabbukum. So a ummah that was centered around the concept of ibadah. And then ummatu ittiba'. The first one was iman, faith. Then ittiba' to follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided us through two things. A revealed book, Quran Munzal, wa Rasulun Mursal. That means there is a book that was revealed to us and a prophet that was chosen to be a qudu, a role model for all of us, uswa, hasan. And not only that, but to follow him. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمْ اللَّهَ. So the vision was very clear and the mission was set and determined and very much designed and specified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a Muslim has no option but to be a abd, a servant of Allah and a follower of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to the principles set in the Quran and the hadith and the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And within this framework, which was clearly set, we have values. So we are the ummah of the Islamic values. One of these is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked a lot about no one should look down to another one because he's from a certain tribe or from a certain race. And he said, لا فضل العربين على أعجمين إلا بالتقوى. So if there is anybody who will talk about equality now in the world, you will just remind him the first one who spoke that was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet took that from the Quran, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. That means the taqwa is the only thing, criteria, the factor that matters and counts in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the eyes of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet did not just say words, he actually practiced that himself as an individual through his family and his companions. And if any one of his companions will come to tell him that somebody put me down because of my color or my race or my social status, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will nicely and kindly and firmly reprimand that companion that you still have traces of jahiliyyah. You still have traces of jahiliyyah. So if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for sure is living among us now, he would have told us that we have many things from the jahiliyyah. There is no doubt about that. But this is not the time for us to focus on that. Let us just go. So let us just say, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honor in the eyes of Allah among you is the one who has taqwa. And the Prophet ﷺ says taqwa is not in your outlooks, it is not in your how you... Taqwa is in the heart. It is something that you feel in your heart and will be implemented in good actions. This is exactly what Imam al-Hasan had said. He said, لَيْسَ الْإِيمَانُ, because now taqwa and iman, they sometimes may refer to one thing. But let us talk about taqwa now for a while. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, he was asked to define taqwa. So I will say it in Arabic and I will try my best to give you the meaning in English to the best I could. Imam Ali, when he was asked about the taqwa, what is this taqwa that was at the center of our iman and which would really make a big difference between between A and B and C in our community? He said that taqwa هي الخوف من الجليل والعمل بالتنزيل والرضا بالقليل والاستعداد ليوم الوحيد.